Ladies and gentlemen.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you all here this evening. I'd like to I think we must have blown a fuse. Could you switch the light back on, please? Could you switch the light back on, please?
Which one?
The round one.
It's on.
And
they're going to do a serious play for you tonight, Hamlet, which I'm sure many... Macbeth, which I'm sure many of you will know. Now, unfortunately, one of the cast, Mrs. Perry Jones, who plays the third witch, Macduff and the Messenger, accident last week. She sustained a very unpleasant leg injury. And as you can imagine, it threw us into a bit of a tizzle. But we needn't have worried because she's been an absolute trooper and insisted on coming along to be in the play tonight. I think that's jolly courageous. Incidentally, Mrs. Perry Jones has just given birth to a bouncing baby boy. In fact, it was a spoonful of his Gerber's stewed apple that she skidded on. Henry, dear, are you going to do that all the way through the play? Well, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our very special guest of honour, who's come all the way from London to adjudicate the festival for us, Mr. George Plum.
Peach.
Mr. Peach Plum.
No. George Peach.
Not Plum.
No.
Oh.
now is eat some dream topping and we'd have a fruit salad. Anyway, it's so good to see your new friend of the drama out there.
You don't kill him for weeks.
I shall mount it with pleasure.
Now, as you will have noticed from your programmes, Mr. Lemon is our special guest is extremely well known in London for his work with the BBC. He has produced a number of plays for Radio 3, including a semi-operatic version of Pope's The Dunciad, which was sung in Polynesian. And a 15-part dramatisation of Sir Robert Walpole's letters to his wig maker. I think I remember that. We're also very pleased to have with us Mrs. Wolstenholme from the Mid-Surrey Federation and Mrs. McKendrick from the Afternoon Guild, who very generously supplied Mr. Pawpaw's table dog. Well, you didn't come here to listen to me chatting away, so on with the show.
We're not quite ready yet.
Oh my goodness.
Well, we're nearly done. Could you go back outside a little bit more or something? Right, Colin, we'll just get this up.
Well, I'm afraid they're not quite ready back there. May I take this opportunity to tell you something about the Guild? We've just celebrated our 30th anniversary.
50th? It was our 50th anniversary.
That was just a slip of the tongue, Felicity.
Well, we started in 1942. It was our golden jubilee.
Do you want to make the announcements, dear?
Well, I would just like to say that on September the 7th...
Yes, I was just coming. On September the 7th, my birthday, Mrs. Rowett will be reading chapter 17
of her unpublished work,
if anybody wants enrolment forms, I'll be in the corridor during the interval.
Shut up!
Can I interest you in a raffle ticket? I can't hear anything.
Exactly! There's supposed to be a play going on!
Oh, crumbs.
Seem to have hit a little snag.
Yes, they can't bloody act.
Did you see this?
Yes, Macbeth,
not so heavy and much heavier.
Thou shalt get king, so there'll be none. So all hail Macbeth and Banquo!
Stay! You empathic speakers, tell me more.
Oh, God, we should have come on.
Members of the society, isn't he, ladies?
Yes,
so reliable.
Take it, Henry. The part's yours.
Leave it out.
I've seen you at rehearsal, mouthing the lines. You know them.
No, I can't act.
No, that's not true.
No,
Well, what else could be bothering you then?
Well, I hardly look the part.
Why don't you take off those glasses? Seek ye no more.
Leave it out.
It's a wonderful part, Henry. It's very well written, you know. I mean, Shakespeare's one of our most talented writers. He's on a par with no coward. And Ivan Novello. You can't pass up a chance like this.
I'm not playing a woman.
Well, there's nothing sissy about playing a woman. And Lady Macbeth, a tough, determined person. She tells all the men what to do, doesn't she? If she were around today, I'm sure she'd be getting into scraps and having a pint with the lads and... What else would she be doing, Felicity?
She'd be going down the disco to pick up girls.
Ah! Oh, she would not be going down to the disco, Felicity. Be sensible.
Forget it.
It's a question of teamwork, Henry. We've been rehearsing twice a week now for 9 months. You can't throw all that away. Throw away our chance of going through to the national finals at Welland Garden City. You can't want that, can you? No. Well, let's stop all this bashfulness and all this silly nonsense about playing a woman. Dawn, Kate, warm up the Carmen Rollers and get him into heel wonder's liberty for this. I want you to go out there as stage manager and come back as star.
Very good.
Till then, enough. Come, friend.
What the hell's the matter with you?
I told you I've lost my voice.
If you wouldn't mind, don't crumble the material. They were my best curtains.
Look.
Oh, my God!
That imbecile has ruined the play!
What imbecile? What do you mean, ruined?
If Henry doesn't need the society, I will. I mean it. I am not joking.
Well, what's the matter? Tell me what's going on.
Talking about the set. Look at it. I could put up a set in the dark.
But what's
set? No fun of it.
Now there came the time of rejoicing.
Why, say, glanced thou art, could all the shelf be. I fear is too much like the milk of human kindness to catch the nearest way.
The king comes here tonight.
What are your tidings?
The king comes here tonight.
Thou art mad to say it. Is thy master with him? Then give him tending.
Right.
He brings grave news. Come dark night, come mysterious spirits. Come before and unsex me. Come to my woman's breast. And take thy milk for gall. Come dark night and parley thee. This is not a blackout!
Oh, goodness.
Great Glam's worthy Cador.
Great Glam's worthy Cador.
Great Glam's worthy Cador.
He just said that.
Greater than both by all hail hereafter.
Greater than both by all hail hereafter. These letters have transported me from the ignorant present to the future in an instant.
My dearest love, Duncan, comes here tonight.
And when goes hence?
Tomorrow, as he proposes.
Tomorrow, no more the sun shall... My famous face is like a book which reads such strange mysteries.
If it were done when it is done, then it were well it were done quickly.
Be so much more the man.
And if we should fail?
But if we should fail, but... Stick your courage to the sticking post, and we'll not fail.
I am settled and bent up. Each corporal agent to his terrible feet. Away and lock the time. False face the high, but the false heart doth know. Mind, a false creation proceeding from the heat which now I draw. Mine eyes are made fools of the other senses, or else worth all the rest. I see thee still under thy blade and dungeon guts of blood. It was not so before. There's no such thing. It is the bloody business that informs thus to mine eyes. Now, on the one half world, nature seems dead, and wicked dreams of you have curtained sleep. Get rid of this thing! Witchcraft celebrates fair Hecate's offering, and with it murder with stealthy pace towards its design moves like a ghost. While I threat, he lives. I go, and it is done. The bell invites me. Hear it not, Duncan, for it is a knell that summons thee to heaven or to hell.
That which had made me drunk had made me bold. That which have given me first have given me far. Hark!
Who's there? What ho?
My husband?
I have done the deed. Didst thou not hear a noise?
I heard the owl scream and the cricket cry. Did you speak?
When?
As you descended? I.
As I descended?
I.
Hark! Who lies in the supper here?
Donald Wine.
Donald Bane!
Oh, him as well.
This is a sorry sight.
My lord, your hands are the same colour as mine. For I shame to wear a heart so white. I hear a knocking at the gate. Let us retire to our chamber. A little water will clear us of this deed.
Ah! Oh! Oh!
And ease our constancy. I hear a knocking at the gate.
To know my deed. To best not know my deed. To know indeed, not my deed. Know how. Wake, Duncan, with thy knocking. I wouldst thou couldst.
Tossing!
Were you getting on the wrong side?
There was a stabbing. Oh, I'm sick and tired.
Here's a knocking indeed. If a man were porter of Hell Gate, he would have altered in the key. Knock, knock, knock. Who is there in the name of Beelzebub? Here's a farmer. More hanged himself on the expectation of plenty. Come in time, have napkins and you about you. You sweat for it. Knock, knock. Who's there in the other devil's name? Faith, here's an equivocator. Who could argue either scale against both scales? Who committed treason enough, for God's sake, if not equivocator, heaven? Oh, come in, equivocator! Knock, knock. Who's there? Faith. Here's an English tailor. Come here for stealing out of French hose. Come in, tailor, here you may roast your goose. Anon, anon, I pray you don't remember the porter.
Henry, I've lost my glasses. Is my master stirring?
Good morrow.
Is the king stirring, a worthy thane?
Not yet.
Ah, he did command me to call timely upon him. I have almost slipped the hour.
I'll bring you to him.
I know 'tis a joyful trouble to you, but yet 'tis one.
The labour we delight in physic's pain. This is the door.
Oh, thank you. I'll make so bold as to call for 'tis my limit. Service.
Get out of the way.
Oh,
What's the matter?
Approach the chamber and destroy your sight with a new gorgon. Do not bid me speak. See, and then speak yourself. Awake, awake! Ring the alarm bell! Murder, treason, Banquo, Donald Rain, Malcolm, awake! Shake off thy downy sleep, death's counterfeit, and look upon death itself. Ring the bell.
The bell!
Ladies and gentlemen, tonight we've been privileged to see a highly individual production of Macbeth done by a group of ladies who certainly know the meaning of the word daring.
We haven't finished yet.
What's that?
We've got another 3 hours to go.
3 hours? What cheering news. Anyway, it's gripping stuff, isn't it? Goodness, gripping.
Trumpet call. And cast us here to parley. Speak! Speak!
Oh, gentle lady, 'tis not for you to hear what I must speak. Ah, Banquo! Ah, Banquo!
Banquo!
Of day,
So now the lated traveller apace finds a timely inn. Oh, now they approach the subject of our walk.
Hark, I hear horses.
Give us a torch there. Oh. And now it's time for us to draw the raffle, in case any of you wondered what this was for. And I think it might be a nice idea if we ask our guest of honour to pick the winning number. Mr. Pear? Hello?
Hello. Hello there.
Hello, everyone. And may I say, what a pleasure it is to be back in Skegness once again. A town I have the greatest affection for.
Would you like to pick the winning number?
Delighted. 42?
Yes. From this bucket.
Oh, that's a much better idea. Just hold your horses, will you? It's a good job I brought my walking shoes.
The main prize tonight, Mr. Lemon,
is a peach meringue pie made by Mrs. Devney.
I think you've got that wrong, haven't you?
Have I?
You said peach meringue pie. Well, that's my name.
Oh, I'm such a... Oh, I'm terribly sorry, such a scatterbrain. You'll have to forgive me, Mr. Peach Meringue Pie. We're going to draw for the main prize in just a minute, but first we have our consolation prize, a lovely little pot of homemade jam, also made by Mrs. Dabney. Her larder's going to be awfully bare, isn't it? Yes, we'll draw for that first, shall we?
The winning ticket is number 101.
101, anyone?
Oh, yes, I've got it.
Oh, good. Well, this is for you, and I'm going to ask Mr. Apricot to present it to you, so would you pass it to him?
Is that for me? You're very kind. All the more so because it was quite unexpected. I shall place it on my table and enjoy it with my breakfast. Delightful.
I'm sorry. I should have told you that's Mrs. Smith's jam.
This is Mrs. Smith's jam. How marvellous. Not only does she win raffles, she also makes preserves. Tell me, you get the fruit from your own garden? Because, you know, we had a wonderful crop of gooseberry this year, and my neighbour Dame Peggy said, George, why don't you make some of your gooseberry wine? And I said, you know what happened the last time I did that? You and me and the vicar. We got absolutely rotten.
We did. Well,
just a quick one before dinner.
Well, this is for the main prize. No peeking, Mr. Peach Meringue Pie.
Forget the meringue pie, will you?
But then we won't have a prize.
The winning ticket is number 22. Clickety click.
22? 22? For a lovely cake made by Mrs. Dabney. An old hand with a wooden spoon.
Oh, come on, Phoebe, draw it again. That's a swing.
Come on.
It's not fair.
Oh, all right, then. We'll have another one, shall we?
I'm going to get Arnick. I can see that. This time the winning ticket is number 11. Two fat ladies?
No, legs.
Sorry, legs. Two fat legs. Anyone? Two fat legs.
What should we do?
Well, I'm...
This is quite legitimate, you know.
Yes, it's the luck of the draw, I suppose. Felicity, dear, have you got...
lovely.
Thank you, Mrs. Dabney. And thank you, Mr. Damson. A stay.
It's been great fun.
Have you had a cup of tea?
I'd love another one.
Well, you come with me. Now... Let's see what happens next. Open sesame. Open sesame.
Remembrance up. Now, good digestion, wake up, appetite, and health.
on both.
Yeah!
twitching of my thumbs. Something wicked this way comes. Open locks, whoever knocks.
How now? Sick of black and midnight hags, what is to do?
A deed without a name.
I conjure you by that which you profess. However you come to know it, answer me.
Say if I'd rather hear it from our mouths or from our masters.
Call, let me see him.
Come high, come low, thyself and office.
Tell me thy unknown power.
He knows thy thought. Hear his speech and say thou not.
Macbeth! Beware, Macduff. Beware the Thane of Fife. Dismiss me. Enough!
Whatever thou art, for thy good caution, thanks.
Here's another, more potent than the first.
Macbeth.
Had I 3 ears, I'd hear thee.
Be bloody, bold, and resolute. Laugh to scorn the power of man. For none of women born shall harm Macbeth.
What need I fear of thee? But then, I'll make assurance double sure and take a bond of fate. Thou shalt not live. What noise is this?
Sheriff!
Thou art too like the spirit of Banquo. Down! Thy crown doth sear mine eyeballs. And thy hair, thy other gold brown bow, is like thirst. Third is like the former. Filthy hags!
Father!
Why do you show me this? A fourth! Start eyes! What will a lie stretch out till the crack of doom? Another yet! A seventh! I'll see no more. And yet an eighth appears. Who bears a glass and shows me many more. And some I see. The twofold balls and treble scepters carry. Horrible sight! Now I see it is true! For the blood fountain of Banquo smiles upon me! And points at them for his! What? Is this so? What is this so?
Aye, sir, this is so. Macbeth shall never.
Aye, sir, this is so. Macbeth shall never, my great sins, the great burn of wood to Dunnison Hill, shall come against him now.
Come on, Cackham.
Where are they? Gone? Let this pernicious hour stand. I, accursed, in the calendar.
Haven't missed the visions, have I? Have I? What was it like? Spooky? What sort of string was it?
Sounds like fun.
Your father's dead. And what will you do now? How will you live?
As birds do, Mother.
What, with flies and worms?
No, with what I get, I mean. And so do they.
Poor bird.
husband.
Why, I could buy me 20 at any market.
Then you will buy them to sell again.
Thou speakst with all thy wit, and yet, i' faith, with wit enough for thee.
Was my father a traitor, mother?
Poor prattler, how thou talkst! What are these faces?
Where's your husband?
I hope in no place so unsanctified as such as thou mayst find him.
He was a murderer.
Thou liest, thou shag-haired fiend.
What? You egg?
Don't know.
Your cry of treachery?
Over there.
In your cry of treachery!
Stop it, Dawn. Dawn, you're annoying me.
Look here. Your cry of treachery!
He has killed me, mother.
Run at the rotter.
Run away, I pray you. You can't run away, I'm supposed to be dead. Tell Mrs. Rees to run away. Run away, Mrs. Rees, I pray you.
Murder! Murder! Wait a minute. Murder!
Gentle was welcome hither. Stand Scotland where it did.
Alas, poor country, almost afraid to know itself. It cannot be called our mother, but our grave, where nothing and who knows nothing was once seen to smile, where moans and groans and shrieks that rent the air are made not marked where violence sorrow seems, a modern ecstasy.
And how does my wife?
Let not your ears despise my tongue forever. Your course. Your wife and babes savagely slaughtered.
What, all? All my pretty chickens and their dam at one fell swoop?
Not in the legions. Can horrid hell come a devil more damned than evils to top Macbeth? Cut short all intermission, front to front. Bring thou this fiend of Scotland and thyself.
This tune goes manly. Come, go we to the king. I'll catch up then.
With you, and yet can perceive no truth in your report. When was it she last walked?
Since His Majesty went into the field. I have seen from her rise from her bed many times. All this while, fast, sleep. Lo you, here she comes.
Her eyes are open.
Are but her senses shut.
Look how she rubs her hands.
It is an accustomed action with her.
Yet here's a spot.
Hark, she speaks.
Observe her, stand close.
What is it she does now?
It is an accustomed action with her.
Yet here's a spot.
Hark, she speaks.
Observe her stand close.
is shut.
Look how she rubs
it. It's an accustomed function.
Yet here's a spot. Yet here's a
spot. Hark, she speaks.
Observe her spy close.
Her eyes are open.
Her senses shut.
Look how she rubs her hands.
It's an accustomed action.
Yet here's a spot.
Hark, she speaks.
Observe her close.
Out, damned spot.
Out, damned spot? Out, I say. Away, soldiers and afeared.
Yet, who would have thought?
I'll tell him! Yet, who would have thought? I'll tell him that there'd be so much blood in such an old man.
Do you mark that?
Do you mark that?
No, that's my mind. Now it's you.
What is it?
I'll tell you.
The Thane of Fife had a wife! Oh, the Thane of Fife had a wife!
No!
The Thane of Fife had a fight.
Where is she now?
I don't know.
What?
I said I don't know!
You say what?
Oh! What? Oh, what? Will these hands of mine ne'er be clean?
Go to.
Go to. Yet here's a spot.
Hark, she
speaks. No!
Go to. You have known what you should not.
She has said what she should not.
You can say that again.
Will these hands of mine ne'er be cleaned and rid of the smell of blood? No perfumes of Arabia will ever rid me of this smell. Now is the winter of our discontent. Made more glorious by the summer sun of yore. The clouds that roar upon this land. In the deep of the ocean bosom buried. To bed. I hear a knocking at the gate. To bed.
Will she now go to bed? Foul whisperings are abroad. Good night.
Farewell, good doctor.
Fare thee well.
Bye.
Lovely castle you have here. Well, keep taking the tablets.
That's better. I couldn't see what I was doing.
The wood of Burnham.
Let every soldier cut him down a bough and carry it before him.
It shall be done.
Well, march we on.
Excuse me, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
Yes?
Oh, you do realise you've only got 10 minutes left.
To do what?
finish the play, of course. Otherwise, you'd be disqualified.
10 minutes?
It's 9 now.
But we've got to get Burnham Wood to dance it, Ain.
Well, I think your only hope is Concord. What's the matter?
It's nothing to worry about, David, dear. It's just that we have to finish the play in 9 minutes.
9 minutes?
No. It's 8 and a half now.
8 and a half? We've got another 3 scenes to do. We can't do them in 8 and a half minutes.
We can if we try, dear. Now, come along, folks. Pacey.
Oh, this is a joke. An absolute joke. How can I be expected to work like this? This is crazy. I hope to God my parents never find out about this. Finish it yourselves. I want nothing more to do with it.
Let all just censures attend the true event and put we on industrious.
Cut it, love, cut it. It's not important. Everybody off. Quick. They all go to Dallas being dressed as pigs, all right? Lady Macbeth, you're next. Come on.
Give me no more reports. Let them fly all till Burnham Wood removed to Dunsinane. I cannot.
Cut it, love, cut it.
What's the boy, Malcolm? Was he not born of woman? Throw physic to the dogs!
Tell them I'm putting out the bloody stain! Lady Macbeth, where are you?
I'll have none of it. I will not be treated like this. I will not have my scene.
What beast was there?
Take this bloody twig!
That did make you break your enterprise to me when durst you were to me?
He's so much Lady Macbeth.
Man.
Lady Macbeth!
Nor how in what place did they adhere? When they made their fitness to me.
Can't even get upset. Look at this junk!
I know what it is to love a babe, and I have given suck. But I know when a babe is smiling in my face that I would rather pluck its nipple from my boneless gum and smash its brains out had I so sworn. We'll never get to where the gum city burns.
Yes, we will all do the part.
Dear, I implore you, if nothing else, think what this would look like in the Guild Journal. Thelma, the one time Polly Bentwright chooses to come and listen to them. What do you mean? Polly Bentwright, drama critic of the Guild Monthly.
I don't believe it! I've never listened to Polly. He's always been a downside too full of himself for my liking.
I know, dear.
And I expect an apology.
You'll have it.
And I want my death scene. I've been rehearsing that death scene for 9 months.
I'll make sure of it, dear, but we do only have 4 and a half minutes, so I will forget it. Shilly, you along with it.
I'll be ready.
Well, the teacher's gone in and the light of friendly the eagle come up. Well, then, of course, with these sheep, we might have met the devil may come in and beat them back. What is that noise?
It is the cry of women, my good lord.
I have always got the taste of being the damage in my sense of the world.
Oh, my God.
Well, you know the words of the bard. All's well that ends well. Now, it's very nice. But those of us who take acting more seriously want our work to be judged by the professionals. So now we come to the moment when we look forward to the constructive criticism of an expert in his field. Mr. George Nectarine.
Thank you, Mrs. Rees, for a charming introduction. I'm sorry, I do hope you will excuse my appearance, but the Guild of Drama Adjudicators is holding a drag ball this evening up at the Five Bells and rushing on there. I can see several of you are going as well. Lovely, see you there. Now, Macbeth, what is it that we think about when we talk about this play? Well, essentially, it's a love story, isn't it? The story of a young married couple and a wife who wants her husband to get on in his job. And how very well that came across in the Ginny Cannon Netherwallop production this evening. What I particularly liked was the producer's refusal to kowtow to the progressives and trendies. What we got was a simple, raw, almost primitive production, which conveyed the tensions and the emotions so very, very clearly. I don't know about you, but those witches, they terrified the life out of me. I'm sure they're all charming ladies in real life, but my goodness, I'm going to have great difficulty in getting to sleep tonight. An exorcist pales in comparison to those women. What about that seething conflict between Macbeth and his wife? We felt it, didn't we? Yes, we did. especially in those little asides, of which I have made a note. I hate you, and you're incompetent. You've messed up my scene. I don't, in all honesty, remember those lines in the original play, but they do so much, don't they, to heighten the significance of the play for the 90s, and indeed for those somewhat younger than that. But joking apart, I found this a passionately involving production. I love that inspired but somehow devastatingly simple device of portraying the remoteness of 11th century Scottish monarchy by playing so much of the action back to front. It worked, didn't it? Yes, it did. It alienated us. We thought, who are these people? They're not like us. They're living in a different world. I wonder, did you notice that very clever and unsettling use of darkness? We'd be watching a particular scene, feeling that we'd come to terms with it, when suddenly we'd be plunged into absolute darkness, prevented from an over-familiarity with those characters by the fact that it was quite impossible to see them. Yes, sir. It's an old trick, an obvious trick. I've seen it done many times before, but it was so effective. Yes, I think that's the word that sums up the production for me. Effective. Look at those marvellous visions. Weren't they fun? I've been in the theatre now for, oh dear, oh Lord, more years than I care to remember, and I still don't know how some of those things were done. Is there a producer here at all? Is he? Oh, Mr. Producer, why don't you stand up and we'll have a good look at you. Oh, there he is. I do believe you've got some supporters there with you. Good. Now, Mr. Producer, I don't want you to give away any of your secrets if you don't want to, but do tell us, how did you get that snow effect?
Toilet paper, actually.
Toilet paper? Good heavens. Louise.
Yes, we wanted to use polystyrene balls, but you know the regulations.
I think it was a jolly good bit of improvisation on your part. A credit to you. I think we could probably have done without the box, but that's a small point. Now, what about those performances? Macbeth. Yes, here was a very rousing portrayal, plenty of light and shade. There were times when we felt very, very sorry for the poor fellow, and others when we absolutely hated him, didn't we? Where are you, dearie?
I'm here.
Yeah, I hated you. Lady Macbeth, a very well rounded And I wonder, incidentally, how many of you out there tonight realized that the part was played by a man?
Never!
Remarkable, wasn't it? And I only found out just now, backstage. Watch out, Edna Everidge. An excellent Banquo. There was a bit of trouble with the projection here. But what a wealth of feeling in those eyes. Something amateurs tend to forget so often. Macduff, I liked enormously. And a lovely touch, wasn't it, to portray her crippled spirit by playing the part on those stark, penetrating crutches. And I'd like to think like this actress because although there was a certain lack of mobility in the second half, she was very, very successful in conveying to us Macduff's pain. In fact, it was quite the most painful performance I've seen in years. The witches I've already mentioned, but some delightful costumes here. And while we're on the subject, bravo the wardrobe department for the whole show. All in all then, a very ambitious choice for these ladies, but one I feel they were fully justified in taking. My only quibble with the production was that for me it lacked a sense of comedy. Macbeth is a serious play, I'm the first to admit it. But there are moments of humour to be found there. And I'm thinking in particular of the porter's scene. But what we got tonight, goodness, was more anguish and despair. Now, don't misunderstand me, Mr. Producer, your toilet paper, it worked a treat. But when that poor fellow lost his glasses over here in the blizzard, I think a lot of us out front, we blinked back a tear, didn't we? Yes, we did. But let's not harp on this. I've had a most enlightening evening, and I think the best thing that I can say in summation is that tonight's performance makes me feel like going home and rereading the play. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's lovely to see you all here this evening, and I hope you'll be able to join us all at the bar after the performance. And I must admit that the Ginny Cannon group have set a standard that's going to be very, very difficult to equal. But I have been passed a note, and I understand that during the forthcoming week here, on Monday, the Wallop Artists, in conjunction with the Evergreen Club, are presenting their version of Ben-Hur. On Wednesday, the Danebury Players are doing Dr. Faustus. Now, aren't they brave? On Thursday, there's a real treat lined up for you. A delightful musical being performed by the Muriel Leach Operatic Society. And they're doing Aida. And I've been asked to know the producer, Mrs. Scott, tells me that she has persuaded her husband, Roddy, to play the saxophone. Now that sounds like fun, doesn't it? Finally, the week is being rounded off with a new production being premiered in this very hall. The Wallop Nursing Home Dramatic Group Over 80s Division. And they're doing O Calcutta. Less than. Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening to me so patiently, and I'm sure that each and every one of you would like to show your appreciation for a wonderfully talented group of ladies who've given a new meaning to the phrase amateur dramatics. The Ginny Cannon Nether Wallop Dramatic Group.
cute about a little cutie? It's her beauty, not brains. Old Father Time will never harm you if your charm still remains. After you grow old, baby, you don't have to be a cold baby. Keep young and beautiful. It's your duty to be beautiful. Keep young and beautiful. If you want to be loved, don't fail to do your stuff with a little pot and a puff. Keep young and beautiful. If you want to be loved, if you're wise, exercise all the fat off. Take it off, off here, off there. When you're seen anywhere with your hat off, wear a Marcel wave in your hair. Take care of all those charms, and you'll always be in someone's arms. Keep young and beautiful if you want to be loved. Take it off, over here, over there. When you're seen anywhere with your hat on, wear a Marcel wave in your hair. Keep young and beautiful. It's your duty to be beautiful. That's right, girls. Keep young and beautiful if you want to be loved.